Welcome everyone. In this lecture we are going to see for the time division multiple access the synchronization in TDMA networks. That is network synchronization. It is required to ensure that all bursts arrive at the satellite in their correct time slots. So timing markers are provided by the reference bus which are tied to a highly stable clock at the reference station and transmitted through the satellite link to the traffic stations. At any given traffic station, detection of the unique word, that is burst code word, in the reference bus signals the start of receiving frame and the marker coinciding with the last bit in the unique word. It would be desirable to have the highly stable clock located abroad the satellite because this would eliminate the variations in propagation delay. So propagation delay arising from the uplink for the reference station, but this is not practical because of the weight and space limitations. The reference burst retransmitted from the satellite can be treated for timing purposes as if they originated from the satellite. The network operates a burst time plan, a copy of which is stored at each earth station. The burst time plan shows each earth station the receive burst intended for it are relative to the SORP, start of receive frame marker. The earth station A and the start of receive frame marker is received after some propagation delay, that is TA, and the burst time plan tells station A that burst intended for it follows at time capital TA after the SORP marker received by it. So likewise for station B, the propagation delay is small t subscript b and the received burst start at capital TB after the SORP markers received at station B. So the propagation delays for each earth station will differ, but typically they are in the region of 120 milliseconds each. The burst time plan also shows a station when it must transmit its burst in order to reach the satellite in the correct time slots. A major advantage of the TDMA mode of operation is that the burst time plan is essentially under software control so that changes in traffic pattern can be accommodated much more readily than is the case with FDMA, where modification to hardwares are required. Against this, implementation of synchronization is a complicated process and corrections must be included for changes in propagation delay, which results from the slowly varying positions of the satellite. In general, the procedure for transmit timing control has two stages. The first is that the need for a station just entering or re-entering after a long delay to acquire its correct slot position, this being referred to as the burst position acquisition. Once the time slot has been acquired, the traffic station must maintain the correct position, and this being known as the burst position synchronization. So in this we can see that this is the satellite clock where respective stations, we can see station A, station B, and start of receive frame marker in a time burst plan has been given. This is the start of receive marker here for A, and this is the start of receive marker for B. That frame will be intended for station B, and this is the propagation delay for station B, and TA is the propagation delay for station A. Open loop timing control. This is the simplest method to of transmit timing. A station transmit at a fixed interval following receptions of the timing markers and according to the burst time plan, and sufficient guard time is allowed to absorb the variations in propagation delay. The burst position error can be large with this method, and longer guard times are necessary, which reduces frame efficiency. Means as we are increasing the large guard times, then frame efficiency will get reduced. These are some of the disadvantages also. For frame times longer than about 45 milliseconds, the loss of efficiency is less than 10%. in a modified version of the open loop method known as adaptive open loop timings, the range is computed at the traffic station from orbital data or from measurements, and the traffic earth station makes its own corrections in timing to allow for the variations in the range. It should be noted that with open loop timing, no special acquisition procedure is required. Then loopback timing control. In loopback refers to the fact that an earth station receives its own transmission from which it can determine the range. Here earth station itself will receive its own transmission and it can determine the range. It follows that the loopback method can only be used where the satellite transmits a global or a regional beam encompassing all the earth stations in the network. A number of methods are available for acquisition process, but basically these all require some form of ranging to be carried out so that a close estimate of the slot position can be acquired. In one method, the traffic station transmits a low level burst consisting of preamble only. The power level is 20 to 25 dB below the normal operating level to prevent interference with other burst, and the short burst is swept through the frame until it is observed to fall within the assigned time slot for the station. The short burst is then increased to full power and fine adjustment in timing are made to bring it to the beginning of the time slot. Acquisition can take up to about 3 seconds in some cases, and following acquisition the traffic data can be added to it. And synchronization can be maintained by continuously monitoring the position of the loopback transmission with reference to the start of receive frame marker. The timing positions are reckoned from the last beat of the unique word in the preamble, and the loopback method is also known as the direct closed loop feedback. The feedback timing control is the method where a traffic station lies outside the satellite beam containing its own transmission. Loopback of the transmission does not, of course, occur, and some other methods must be used for the station to receive ranging information. Feedback timing controls where traffic stations lies outside the satellite beam, and but they will contain their own transmission. So loopback of the transmission will not occur here, and some other methods that we can use for the station to receive the ranging information, where the synchronization information is transmitted back to the earth station from a distant station, and this is termed as feedback closed loop control. Means as it is out of its range, outside the range, then that will send back to the earth station. The distant station may be a reference station as in the Intelsat network, or it may be the another traffic station which is designated as a partner. During the acquisition stage, the distant station can feed back information to guide the position of the short burst, and once the correct time slot is acquired, the necessary synchronization information can be fed back on a continuous basis. In the figure that feedback closed loop control method for two earth stations A and B has been shown, and the start of receive frame marker is used as a reference point for the burst transmission. The reference point, which denotes the start of transmit frame, has to be delayed by a certain amount, and that has been as DA for the earth station A and DB for the earth station B. We can see here that timing relations in the TDMA system has been given, whereas this is the satellite clock and these are A and B are the earth station. This is the start of receive frame, this is the time delay, propagation delay for earth station A. DA is the time slot has been given here, and this is the start of transmit frame. Here we can identify this is the start of transmit frame for station A. Similarly, this is the start of transmit frame for the B, and these will be get received, and after that this is the time delay time, and then it will get transmitted to the stations A and station B respectively. So these are the timings we can say here, TA and transmitting, here we are receiving here. This is necessary so that the start of transmit frame reference points for each earth station coincide at the satellite transponder and the traffic burst, which are transmitted at their designated times after the start of transmit frame, arrive in their correct relative position at the transponder. As we have seen here in the diagram, that they will arrive at the correct position of the transponder here, and then only it will get transmitted. Where we can see that each frame will get delayed by a time delay dA for A station, and this is dB for the B station. The total time delay between any given satellite clock pulse and the corresponding start of transmit frame is constant, and we can see that in the figure C that delay time is given as equal to twice of TA plus DA for station A and twice of TB plus DB for the station B. And for earth station I, the delay DI is determined as 2 into T of I plus DI is equal to C. Why we are taking twice the time delay? Because before the receiving frame, that is start of receive frame, we have the time delay TA for station A as well as for station B. And after the start of time transmit frame, again there are the delay times TA and TB. So we are adding these two time intervals as well as the delay before the start of transmit frame DA. So respectively, the total delay is TA plus DA plus TA for A station and TB plus DB plus TB for station B. So the total time is 2TI plus DI is equal to C, where C is nothing but the corresponding delay battery, total time delay. So this in the Intelsat network, C will be approximately given as 288 milliseconds. For a truly geostationary satellite, the propagation delay TI would be constant. And however, the station keeping maneuvers are required to keep a geostationary satellite at its assigned orbital position, and hence this position can be held only within the certain tolerances. In the Intelsat network, the variation in satellite position can lead to a variation of up to plus minus 0.55 milliseconds in the propagation delay. In order to minimize the guard time needed between the bursts, this variation in propagation delay must be taken into account in determining the delay, that is DI, required at each earth station. So as already there is some propagation delay, we can minimize the guard time also. In Intelsat network, the DI the numbers are updated every 512 frames and period of 1.024 seconds based on the measurements and calculations of the propagation delay times made at the reference station. The DI numbers are transmitted to the earth station through the CDC channel in the reference burst, where DI is the constant. The use of traffic burst preamble along with the reference burst to achieve synchronization is the most common method, but at least one other method not requiring preambles has been proposed by NUSPL and DPDA. There are certain types of packet satellite networks which are closely related to TDMA in which synchronization is not used. The unique word detection. The unique word UW or burst code word is used to establish burst timing in TDMA, and the basic arrangement for detecting this UV we can see in the diagram. The received beat streams is passed through a shift register which forms part of a correlator. As the beat stream moves through the register, the sequence is continuously compared with the stored version of the unique word. When correlation is achieved, indicated by a high output from the threshold detector, the last bit of the unique word provides the reference point for timing purposes. It is important, therefore, to know the probability of error in detecting the unique word. Two possibilities have to be considered here. One is termed as the miss probability, is the probability of the correlation detector failing to detect the unique word even though it is present in the bit stream. The other termed as the probability of false alarm is the probability that the correlation detector misreads a sequence as the unique word. Both of these will be examined in turn. The first probability is miss probability. Let E represents the maximum number of errors allowed in the unique word of length n bits, and let I represents the actual number of errors in the unique word as received. So some of the conditions that we have to apply: when ISE, the detected sequence is declared to be the unique word; when I is greater than E, the detected sequence n is declared not to be the unique word, that is unique word is missed. So these conditions we have to apply, that when ISE, detected sequence is declared to be the unique word, and I is greater than E, detected sequence is declared not to be the unique word, that is the unique word is missed. Let P represent the average probability of error in transmission. The probability of receiving a sequence n containing I errors in any one particular arrangement is Pi is equal to P raised to I into bracket 1 minus P raised to n minus I. The number of combinations of n things taken I at a time, usually written as nci, is given by nci is equal to n factorial by I factorial into n minus I factorial. The probability of receiving a sequence of n bits containing I error is therefore P of I is equal to nci pn. This is the figure where the basic arrangement for detection of the unique word has been given. So we can see here, this is the input bit stream is given here, and out bit stream we can calculate. This is the threshold detector, and summation is given. The stored unique words are given over here. Now, since the unique word is just such a sequence that we have seen in the previous equation gives the probability of unique word containing I errors, the condition for a misoccurring is that I is greater than E, and therefore the miss probability is P miss is equal to summation I is equal to E plus 1 to N into Pi, which is written out in full with this as P miss is equal to probability of missing is equal to summation I is equal to E plus 1 to N, N factorial divided by I factorial into N minus I factorial into P raised to I 1 minus P raised to N minus I. So this equation gives the average probability of missing the unique word even though it is present in the shift register of the correlator. Because this is an average probability, it is not necessary to know any specific value of I. Then the next probability is false detection probability. Consider a sequence of N which is not the unique word, but which would be interpreted as the unique word even if it differs from it in some number of bit positions E, and let I represent the number of bit positions by which the random sequence actually does differ from the unique word. The E represents the number of acceptable bit errors considered from the point of view of the unique word, although they may not be error in the message they represent. Likewise, I represents the actual number of bit errors considered from the point of view of the unique word, although they may not be error in the message they represent. So E represents the acceptable bit error and I represents the actual number of bit errors. The number of combinations of n things taken I at a time is given as we have seen the earlier equations. Hence, the number of words acceptable as the unique word is W is equal to summation I runs from 0 to E n into C of I. The number of words which can be formed from a random sequence of n bits is 2 raised to n. And on the assumptions that all such words are equiprobable, the probability of receiving any one particular word is 2 raised to minus n. Hence, the probability of a false detection is PF is equal to 2 raised to minus n W, and the in full we can write it as probability of f is equal to 2 raised to minus n false probability. 2 raised to minus n is equal to summation I runs from 0 to e n factorial by I factorial into n minus I factorial. This is an average probability. It is not necessary to know a specific value of I, and beat error rate does not enter into the calculation. The last part of the TDMA frame is the traffic data. The traffic data follow the preamble in a burst. As we have seen, the traffic data sub-burst is further subdivided into time slots addressed to the individual destination stations. Any given destination station selects only the data in the time slots intended for that station. As with FDMA networks, TDMA networks can be operated with both pre-assigned and demand assigned channels, and examples of this we will see here. The greater the fraction of frame time that is given over to traffic, the higher is the efficiency. The concept of frame efficiency that we can discuss also here. So this is we have seen here the traffic data, which is for the TDA frame, but will include that reference burst, then preamble and the traffic data. So the traffic data will again include here, the traffic data will include the time slots TOP, TOC, up to TOZ, and Q is the postamble. So frame efficiency and channel capacity. The frame efficiency is a measure of the fraction of frame time used for the transmission of traffic. Frame efficiency may be defined as eta F is equal to traffic bits by total bits. So alternatively, we can write it as 1 minus overhead bits divided by total bits. The equation, in these equations, bits per frame are implied, and the overhead bits consist of the sum of the preamble, the postamble, the guard intervals. It means that overhead bits will include sum of the preamble bits, postambles, guard intervals, and the reference burst bits per frame. The equation may be stated in terms of symbols rather than bits, or the actual times may be used here. For a fixed overhead shows that a longer frame or greater number of total bits results in higher efficiency. However, the longer frames requires larger buffer memories and also add to the propagation delay. Synchronization also may be made more difficult, keeping in mind that the satellite position is varying with time. It is clear that a lower overhead also leads to higher efficiency, but again reducing synchronizing and guard time may result in more complex equipment being required. The wise channel capacity of a frame is the wise channel capacity of the transponder being accessed by the frame, found from the frame efficiency and the beat rate. So let RB be the beat rate of a wise channel, and let there be a total of n wise channels shared between all the earth stations accessing the transponder. The total incoming traffic beat rate to a frame is nRB. The traffic beat rate of the frame is mu of FRT, and therefore it is given as n into RB is equal to efficiency, channel efficiency, into beat rate, traffic beat rate, RTDMA, or eta is given as NF into RTDMA divided by RB. So this is nothing but the traffic beat rate has been given here in terms of the channel efficiency. So in this lecture for the TDMA, we have seen the synchronization in TDMA networks and all the different loop timings we have seen for the TDMA systems. In the next lecture, we are again going to see the other TDMA factors.